The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness, from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
Well, if you're new, my name is Justin Hansen, and I am the lead pastor here at New Heights Church, and I may be biased, but I think this is one of the greatest churches in all the world. And so I want to just say how excited we are, delighted that you're here with us, especially if you're a first-time visitor. We love God's word so much that we preach it verse by verse. So we will go through books of the Bible, and we just finished up our series in the book of Haggai. And during the month of December, every year, we take a pause from preaching verse by verse, and we focus on texts that are applicable to Christmas. So Jesus as our Messiah, our Savior, and our hope. Amen. I love Christmas. I am so excited. In my home, we celebrate Christmas in November. I just, you know, if Walmart doesn't sell Thanksgiving stuff, then we kind of bypass Thanksgiving, and the tree goes up like October 31st. That's just what we do. And I love Christmas. Love the lights. Just love it all. It's my favorite time of the year. But more than all of the lights, I love it because what we're celebrating, especially as a church, the birth of Jesus Christ. I mean, this is a game changer. Come on, right? This is the foundation of what we believe. And so what an awesome time we can come together. We can go to God's word. We can look at how amazing it is that God fulfills his promises. When God makes a promise, he comes through. Somebody say amen, right? And so I want to start this Advent season today by asking a very simple question. All right, I want to ask, where is your hope? Where is your hope today? Again, I think it's ironic coming off the Ohio State loss. I have to ask, how many of you were hoping yesterday that the Buckeyes would beat Michigan besides Wendy? How many were hoping the Buckeyes would pull off a win? Where's your hope today? Now, I know I'm teasing, but seriously, think about it for a minute. Is your hope in the economy? Is it in your job? Is it in your health? What about your plans for the future? Maybe you're hoping for things to get better or for your situation to change, for some breakthrough in your life. I mean, if we look around the world today, does it feel like we're in a season of hope or does it feel like a season of darkness? Here we are in 2024, and if we're not careful, we can be swallowed up by the darkness. There's news about political turmoil, economic uncertainty, wars, health scares. It's enough to make anybody feel like we're heading into a deep winter, and maybe that's how you feel right now. Like you're surrounded by darkness and you're just waiting for something to change. And I don't care if you're brand new to Christianity or if you've been a Christian your entire life, there are times where you feel overwhelmed by circumstances. There is. I mean, you can continue to grow in your faith. You might be a Christian and you've been serving God for 50 years and you're a saint, and there's still going to be times where you just feel overwhelmed by the darkness. So this is something that we will face our entire life as followers of Jesus. But here's the good news of Advent. Hope has already come. You don't have to wait for it. It's here. It's in the person of Jesus Christ. And And I want to start today by telling you a story that I really think captures the essence of what we're talking about. Have you ever heard of Viktor Frankl? Anybody ever? Now, if you've been at New Heights, you've heard me. I usually share a story about Viktor Frankl, well, every Christmas. One of my favorite stories of all time. Viktor Frankl was a Jewish psychiatrist who survived the horrors of Nazi concentration camps, including Auschwitz. In fact, when I went to Auschwitz, I got to see where Viktor Frankl was held. Viktor Frankl lost everything. He lost his family, he lost his friends, he lost his career, he lost his health. He spent years in some of the most brutal, dehumanizing conditions imaginable. He lived through starvation, torture, and the constant threat of death. And yet, in the midst of that unimaginable darkness, Viktor found something that kept him going, and it was not physical strength, it wasn't good luck, it was hope. Not just any kind of hope, it was this very deep, unshakable sense of meaning. He observed something that was remarkable while he was in the camps. He observed that the people who survived were not the ones who were the strongest or the healthiest. No, the ones who survived were those who had a why to live. He said, those who have a why to live can bear with almost any how. I'm going to say that again. Those who have a why to live can bear with almost any how. That's powerful. He survived not because he had any guarantee of ever getting out, but because he had hope. And his hope was rooted in the belief that life had meaning even in suffering. So he believed that if he could survive, he could use that experience to help others find meaning in their pain. And that kept him going. That was his fuel. He held on to the conviction that even in the darkest moments, life had a purpose. And that purpose would pull him through. So let me ask you this again. Where is your hope today? What are you clinging to when things feel dark? When life gets tough, where do you turn? Because if you're not clinging to something unshakable, something beyond this world, the darkness can be overwhelming. And today we're looking at a passage from the prophet Isaiah where he foretells the coming of the Messiah. And every Christmas there's this song that comes around. I love to sing it. In fact, Enya sings it really good. And Celine Dion. If she sings a song, it's good, okay? Yeah. I was humiliated yesterday driving through Starbucks because the barista said, what's your favorite Christmas album? And I said something like Glen Campbell, you know. And my daughter goes, that's not true. He loves Celine Dion. I said, Allie, be quiet. I said, the kids say the craziest things. But you've heard this song, right? O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lowly exile here until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. We all know that song, right? We know the words, they're familiar. But I wonder if we really feel them. Think about this for a second. These words were written about Israel during one of the most difficult times. Why was it difficult? Well, Think about it. They were under oppression, living in exile, and they were waiting for God to fulfill his promise to send the Messiah. And so there's this certain ache in those lyrics when you listen to it. There's a longing. There's a cry for deliverance. Come, Emmanuel. You guys ever cried, oh, Lord, come, Jesus, come? Because my grandma would always say that whenever something would happen. And, oh, Jesus, come. Lord, Jesus, come. She always would say it. When President Bill Clinton was elected, boy. Grandma Hansen, come, Lord Jesus, come. She had to watch me for 1 week when my parents were gone at a conference, and she had to do the parent-teacher conference. Lord Jesus, come. Over and over in the car. Sorry, Grandma, that my parent-teacher conference pushed you over the edge. But there's a longing, there's a real cry for deliverance in that song, Come Emmanuel. Not just a sweet Christmas carol, but a desperate plea from people who had been waiting for hundreds and hundreds of years, waiting in darkness, waiting for a light that had not yet appeared. But here's the message of Advent. Jesus is our hope. I mean, Advent, literally, it's a word that means arrival. And here's the thing. When Jesus first arrived, he came as Savior. In fact, the angels declared, for to you is born this day in the city of David, a Savior who is Christ the Lord. He came to save us. That was his mission the first time. But the second time he comes, he's coming as judge. I know the world doesn't want to hear that. I know pastors are afraid to preach that. But you can't have Christmas without preaching it. First time he came to save the world. The second time he comes, he's coming as judge. The Bible says that when he returns, he's going to gather those who have longed for his appearing, those who have put their hope in him. And right now, we stand between those two arrivals. We're waiting. We're living in the in-between. And I don't know about you, but it sure feels like a lot of things are changing around us. The circumstances of our lives are shifting daily, sometimes minute by minute. And that's exactly why Advent matters. It's an invitation for you and for me to step back from the chaos, to zoom out from our daily grind, and to remember the big picture of God's salvation plan. I can't think of anything more important to preach during Christmas. For you and I just to step back for a moment and remember and get our perspective aligned with his word. Remember the story of Christmas. Remember why Jesus came the first time and remember why he's coming a second time. It's important. Because again, sometimes it just feels like we're waiting in the darkness. And I love the message of Christmas because the message of Christmas yells. Hope is not just a Christmas sentiment. Hope is a weapon for the darkness. Hope is something you can stand on, something that can hold you steady when everything around you is shaking. And I know we talk about hope all the time, don't we? I hope my team wins, right? I hope the Bengals make the playoffs. Hope this new manager for the Reds will actually do something. I hope the Buckeyes can win a national championship. Hope our spouse remembers our anniversary or our birthdays. How many of you guys hate the question when your wife asks you, do you know what today is? I hate that. When she asks that, I'm sweating like you wouldn't believe. What have I missed? I hate it when Liz asks me, do you know what today is? My mind is just racing. And for Liz, she remembers everything. I mean, it might be the first time we shared a Starbucks drink 18 years ago, and I'm supposed to remember that. How am I supposed to remember? It's hard enough to remember three kids' birthdays and anniversary. I got to remember when we shared a Starbucks drink. We go anywhere. Do you remember what we did here? Yeah. How could I forget? She's learned to ask me what happened here. A lot happened. So much happened, it's hard to forget. Do you remember what happened here? It becomes a war of words. Anyway, I digress. We hope for all kinds of things, right? But is that really hope? Is that the kind of hope the Bible talks about? Or is hope something deeper, something more secure? Tell you something, biblical hope is not just a wish. It's an anchor for the soul. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. Hope as a weapon against darkness. Look, if you are going through it, and I've told you before, I've been very transparent as your pastor. It doesn't matter how long you've served the Lord. It doesn't matter if you're a pastor serving in full-time ministry or you're a dentist, doctor, police officer, firefighter. There are times where you just feel overwhelmed. And hope seems to be overtaking. And you've got to not hope. Boy, we love that when that happens. When darkness seems so overwhelming that it's just overtaking your life, you need to use hope as a weapon. To understand real hope, we need to throw out the cultural version of it. You know, the wishful thinking kind of hope. Because if you're living with that wishful thinking, you're probably living without real hope. Today, I want you to walk out of here with a whole new perspective on what hope is, a confident expectation that God is going to come through. That's what the Advent season's all about, the coming of Jesus, the fulfillment of God's promise to his people. It's not a wish, it's a promise fulfilled. And Isaiah 9 paints this picture of a world in darkness, a world under oppression, burdened by sin, brokenness, and just living in complete hopelessness. But in this darkness, God promises light. And in this broken world, God promises a Messiah who will bring hope. And this is where we've got to start. So because the hope described here isn't just a wishful thought or something we hope might happen, this is biblical hope that we're looking at today. And it's built on a solid foundation. It's built on God's promises, which never fail. I love what Timothy Keller says. He says, the world needs a hope that is stronger than circumstances, stronger than culture, and stronger than feelings. This is what the church needs to remember. Hope in Jesus Christ. We try so hard to compete with the world, to give people an experience, to give people a feeling. We've become experts at it in Pentecostal circles where we will manipulate people's emotions and feelings to get them at the altar so that we can pat ourselves on the back and say, we had 20, 30 people at the altar today. The world doesn't need to be entertained. They could go anywhere outside these doors and get entertainment. And I'll tell you what, their entertainment is gonna beat our entertainment. If that's what we exist and that's our sole purpose, we're gonna lose every time. No, I want people to come through these doors and I want people to experience hope because that's what they desperately need. The world can't offer it to them, hope. And so I loved what Pastor Jonah said. Pastor Jonah said, this is the time to invite all of your friends who don't know Jesus, not because we're gonna entertain them, not because Santa Claus is gonna parachute from the ceiling down, not because we're gonna have reindeer come through on a Sunday morning. I don't know what else I could do to entertain people. I could dress up as Santa Claus and preach one Sunday. No, I want you to invite friends because we're gonna talk about the living hope. I want you to invite friends because we're gonna talk about Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, the only one who could change their life. That's why I want you to invite friends who don't know Jesus, loved ones, family members who don't know Jesus, because just like Timothy Keller said, the world needs a hope that is stronger than circumstances, stronger than culture, and stronger than feelings. We're gonna preach that Jesus today and the next 3 weeks, amen? All right, so Susan, you did an awesome job reading that passage. So if you're writing notes, write this down. Hope's not a wish, it's a confident expectation. So that's what we're gonna begin. I know I've talked about it, but we're gonna address it again. Hope's not a wish, it's a confident expectation. In fact, in Isaiah 9, we see the promise of a great light that's gonna shine on the people who walked in darkness. But that promise wasn't just a vague wish. The light is the Messiah, and God is guaranteeing that he is going to come. He will bring deliverance. He will bring joy. Hope, now, in this context, isn't based on wishful thinking, but it's based on God's certain promise to act. So think about it like this. When you hope for something, what are you really doing? You're expecting it to happen, aren't you? I know I keep beating a dead horse, but yesterday a lot of people expected the Ohio State Buckeyes to win. Right? But if that's just a wish and there's no confidence behind it, then it's really just a fleeting desire. I think yesterday proved that. But here Isaiah gives us a promise, and it's a promise to anchor our hope. In verse 2, he says, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Just so you know, this is a future hope he's talking about. The light hasn't come at this point, but the certainty of its coming is already being proclaimed. The expectation of this light is rooted in God's unshakable faithfulness. Now that's what we need today, isn't it? A confident expectation that God is going to do what he said he would do. That's the kind of hope that we find in Jesus Christ, certain and unshakable. Biblical hope isn't a wish, it's a confident expectation anchored in the promises of God. I've told you before to pray back the promises of God. Because some of us, if we've grown up in church, all of us know this, right? And yet we struggle to place our hope in this. If I'm gonna be real honest with you, just this last week, I was pretty much crying at a friend's house and I had to have a friend remind me of this. Justin, you're putting your hope in circumstances. Well, I'm a pastor. I preach every week. I should know this, right? I get paid to study God's Bible, God's word. I get paid to study the Bible and then to teach the Bible and to preach the Bible. And I've preached it from the stage over and over and over and over again. And yet here I was, 41 years old, and I had to have my friend tell me, you are placing your hope in circumstances. You're not placing your hope or your confidence in the promises of God. So like a child, he had to take out his Bible with me. And we had to look up verse by verse, different verses. Go through the verses. What's God promising you, Justin? What's he said to you here? Now, maybe in your life, I don't know where you're placing your hope. Maybe you're hoping for things to get better in your job. Maybe you're hoping for things to get better in your marriage or your health. And those are good desires, by the way. But remember, real hope, and write this down, real hope doesn't come from circumstances. It comes from the promises of God. The hope that we have in Jesus Christ is secure. It's not a wish. It's a guaranteed future because it's rooted in the one who has already come and will come again. Number two, if you're writing notes, or taking notes, write this down. Hope is secure because it is anchored in the unchanging character of God. And we see this here in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. And by the way, we're gonna be kind of unpacking this the next 3 weeks, this passage. So today, don't worry if you feel like I haven't gone and dug deep. We're gonna do that over the course of this month. Isaiah goes on to describe the Messiah with names that reveal God's character. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. So these titles, they show us something profound about the character of the one who is coming. And here's the connection. Because God's character does not change, the hope that we have in him is secure. You see, God's promises, they're not like the promises of people. People fail us. We fail ourselves. My kids remind me all the time, I hate cell phones. And I hate iPads. And the kids nowadays have to have, if it was up to me, my kids wouldn't have a cell phone or an iPad until they're like 18. But the schools are handing these things out now because this is how kids do school. So like Liam has started recording me when I don't know that he's recording me. Liam has posted me live. He didn't even know he did it, but the other day he told me, you said if I got good grades, you'd buy me a hamster. I never said that. Sure enough, he pulled it out. It's like that commercial where they throw out the flag and you could go replay it. Liam pulls out his iPad, hits play, and there I am saying, if you get good grades, I'll buy you a hamster. What on earth possessed me to say something like that? I don't even know what I was thinking. And he's recorded it. Well, I said, Liam, I don't know. You may have got me after I passed my kidney stone. I may have been on a lot of medication when I said that. But I make promises all the time that even when I don't mean to fail, I fail. Because people fail us. And we fail ourselves, but God never fails. His word is unchanging, and because of that, our hope can be secure. You know, it's like a ship, the anchor on a ship. The ship's anchor doesn't just hold the boat in place because it's heavy, it holds because it's anchored to something solid. When God promises to send his son, and when God promises that his son will bring peace, that promise is as solid as God's own character. When we place our hope in Jesus, we're not hoping in someone who's gonna disappoint us. We're hoping in the mighty God who never, ever fails. God will do what he said he would do because he's faithful. He's unchanging, and he's variable. So if you're writing notes, I want you to write this down. Hope is not built upon your circumstances, but on the unchanging character of God. Are you facing something today that feels overwhelming, something that makes you doubt your future? Because if you are, then you need to look to the unchanging character of God. His character doesn't shift like the tides. He's the mighty God, the Prince of Peace, and he's faithful. And because of that, you can be confident that he will come through for you. Our hope is anchored in the unchanging truth of who God is. You know, I love the story of Elizabeth Elliot. Jim Elliot. I don't know if you guys have ever heard of Jim Elliot or Elizabeth Elliot, but she was a widow. Jim Elliot was her husband, a missionary, and Jim Elliot, along with four other missionaries, were killed in 1956 while trying to evangelize the Wadani people in Ecuador. The movie The End of the Spear is based on those four missionary lives. But Jim and his team were speared to death by members of the tribe despite their peaceful efforts to make contact and share the gospel. And the news of his death shocked the world. And it left Elizabeth a widow at the young age of 29 with a baby daughter, Valerie, to raise. And in the face of this unimaginable loss, Elizabeth turned to God's promises. And I love going and watching some of the interviews. They have some of these interviews recorded, especially the secular news agencies. Almost it seemed like they wanted to get her to say something that would be negative about the God that she served. It was almost like they were trying to trap her. And they would just ask her silly, you know, questions. How can something like this happen and you still believe in God or have faith in a good God? And in a letter shortly after his death, she wrote this, and this is just so powerful. She wrote this and said, "The will of God is not something you add to your life. It's a course you choose. You either line yourself up with the Son of God, or you capitulate to the principle which governs the rest of the world." See, rather than becoming bitter or giving up on God, Elizabeth trusted in his sovereignty and in his plan, even when it didn't make sense. She was able to do this because her hope was grounded in the belief that God's purposes were far greater than her own understanding. In fact, she later returned to the same tribe with her young daughter and over time helped lead many members of the tribe to Jesus, including some of the very men who had killed Jim, her husband. Her story is one of profound trust in God's promises. She famously said this, "The secret is Christ in me, not me in a different set of circumstances." Now, that one will get you thinking. I can't tell you how many times I've prayed, "Lord, deliver me from the circumstance." But her perspective was different. Her perspective is, "The secret is Christ in me, not me in a different set of circumstances. God, help me when I'm facing difficult times to pray that. Help me to realize the power is you and me, not in whatever I'm facing." Right? And when that's your perspective, it allows you to continue the mission that God has you on. And I hope you realize this by now. If you have said yes to Jesus, you are on a mission. He has a purpose for your life. She would later go on to write numerous books, including Through the Gates of Splendor, which was about Jim's life and his death, and The Shadow of the Almighty, which encouraged Christians to hope in God's sovereignty and eternal promises, even when they face difficult situations. Her book, The Shadow of the Almighty, helped me so much when I was walking with my dad as he was losing the battle to brain cancer. Remember that. I'm going to say it one more time. The secret is Christ in me, not me in a different set of circumstances. I'm going to tell you right now, New Heights Church, listen to me. You can insert your name in there. The secret is Christ in you, not you in a different set of circumstances. That means no matter what you're facing right now, Christ wants to do something. No matter what situation or circumstance you find yourself in right now, God wants to work in your life and in that circumstance. The power is the fact that Christ is living inside of you. It doesn't need to change the circumstances. I know we do altar calls all the time where people are coming up and praying that God changes the circumstances. When you get to respond to the altar today, I don't want you to pray that. I want you to pray, God, help me see. Help me see that the secret is you and me, not me in a different set of circumstances. Man, that perspective will change your life. Number three, hope fixes our gaze on Jesus, the fulfillment of the promise. We see this in verses 6-7, but the ultimate reason that you and I have hope today is because of the Messiah. Look at verses 6-7. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end. This prophecy is all about Jesus, the Messiah, who would come as a child but would also be the king. I mean, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem, the Israelites didn't fully understand the fullness of that promise, but we do. Jesus came and he will come again. Our hope is not found in what we can do, but in what Jesus has already done. The baby in the manger is the mighty God who will rule forever. He's the Prince of Peace. He's the one who brings ultimate peace to our hearts and to this world. Now, you guys remember the story in Matthew chapter 14, verse 22-33? One of my all-time favorite stories. Growing up in Sunday school, this was my favorite story. Jesus sends his disciples ahead in a boat while he goes off to pray, and a storm comes. And it's a bad storm. I mean, waves are crashing, the wind is howling, and then out of nowhere, they see something. No, they see someone walking on the water towards them. The disciples freak out. They're convinced it's a ghost, but then Jesus speaks. He says, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." At this point, Peter, being Peter, calls out, "Lord, if it's really you, let me come to you on the water." I love Peter. And Jesus says, "Come." So Peter, full of faith, or maybe just full of Peter, I don't know, climbs out of the boat and he starts walking on the water towards Jesus. But here's the thing, it doesn't last. What happened? Remember, as long as Peter's eyes are on Jesus, he's walking on the water. But the moment he takes his eyes off Jesus, he starts noticing the wind. He starts noticing the storm, the circumstances around him, and he begins to sink. And what does he do? He cries out, "Lord, save me. Save me." Now here's the amazing part. Jesus immediately reaches out and grabs him. He doesn't let him go. He pulls him up and he asks, "Why did you doubt?" Why did Peter sink? Because he took his eyes off Jesus. And that, my friends, is the problem with a lot of us today. We start well. We start with faith. We start with our eyes on Jesus, but then we get distracted. The wind picks up, the waves crash. The world starts looking a little too big and Jesus starts looking a little too small. And suddenly we find ourselves sinking beneath the waves of fear, doubt, and anxiety. Oh, I've been there before. The storm is real. The distractions are real. But listen to me, church, the problem is not the storm. I'm not here today to tell you that you don't have real issues in your life, that you are not facing difficult circumstances. I wouldn't do that. No, the storm is real. It's legit. Those waves are big. They're crashing down on you. Some of you are going through horrible, horrible circumstances, facing terrible things. But the problem's not the storm. The problem is that we've taken our eyes off Jesus. That's what the storm usually will do. It takes our eyes off Jesus. Now, let me be clear. Jesus didn't leave Peter to drown. Thank God, right? He saved him. And he's going to save you too. Grace, top to bottom. Faith, beginning to end. Jesus saves us and he sustains us. The Christian life is not a start by faith, finish by works deal. It's a walk of faith. We don't get saved by faith and then start a self-improvement project to make ourselves look better. It's not what it is. We walk by faith. We run by faith. It's like the author of Hebrews says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. The race, this life of faith, is not easy. It's a battle. It's a battle. And we're running in the midst of a world that is constantly trying to trip us up, pull us off course, distract us from the finish line. And the biggest distraction, and I'm not getting off course, I promise, this lines up. The biggest distraction, the thing that can so easily trip us up, is taking our eyes off of Jesus. And you want to know what the weight is that so easily entangles us? In the book of Hebrews, self-righteousness. Listen to me, my friends, listen. The idea that we can do this on our own, it's the pride that whispers in our ears, you've got this. You can handle this. You don't need to rely on Jesus so much. And we start looking to our own good works. We start looking to our own spiritual disciplines, our theology, and all of a sudden they become ends in themselves instead of the means by which we grow closer to Jesus. Let me say this loud and clear. It is not about looking more holy, more put together, more theological. It's about deepening our relationship with Jesus. Every good work must be done to glorify Jesus. Every spiritual discipline is a way to know Him more intimately. Every time we open the Bible, it's not just to gain knowledge, it's to stir our hearts towards Jesus. Every step of faith is a step towards Jesus. The goal is not to become better Christians, but to become more like Jesus. To walk with Him, to fix our eyes on Him, to endure to the end. Now, I'm not going to lie to you. I told you, it's not going to be easy. The Christian life is hard. You're going to face storms. You're going to face trials. You're going to face doubts. But there is a joy, an eternal joy, a hope that awaits for you that is beyond anything you can imagine. It's a hope that comes from being united with Jesus forever. And the beautiful thing is this, He's the one who's going to carry you through all the way to the finish line. Jesus is the author and perfecter of your faith. Jesus is the one who will present you blameless before the Father. Jesus is the one who's going to see you through to the end. So what do we do? What do we do when we feel hopeless, when we feel like we're in a dark world and it's overwhelming us? We fix our eyes on Jesus, the hope of the world. We keep our eyes on Jesus, we finish the race. When we keep our eyes on Jesus, we have a faith that lasts, even when the waves of life try to swallow us whole. Let me say it again, fix your eyes on Jesus. Some of you say, but I don't feel it. You can preach it all you want, Pastor Justin, but I don't feel it. It's not a feeling. This is not a feeling. Say it enough, stand on His promise, and it's gonna work, I promise you. And it's the only thing in this life that'll work. You can go chase all of it out there and you won't find it. This is where it's at, right here. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Keep looking to Him even when you don't feel it, because He's the only one. He's the only one who's gonna keep you afloat in the storm. He's the only one who's going to carry you to the end. The life of faith is about walking and running with your eyes firmly fixed on Jesus. Whatever distractions come your way, whatever storms hit you, keep looking at Jesus. Keep going to His word. Keep praying His promises. It may not feel like it's working in your life, but I promise you, God's promises are true. He delivers every single time. Keep looking to Jesus. Don't operate based on feeling anymore. Operate based on faith. Keep your eyes on Jesus. He's the promise. He's the goal. He's the fulfillment of everything that God has promised, Jesus. So today, here we are celebrating hope. But not just any kind of hope, real hope. Hope that's not just wishful thinking, but a certain hope that we can count on because it's anchored in Jesus. So in this season of Advent, we're not just waiting for a holiday. We're not just waiting for better circumstances. We're waiting for Jesus, Savior of the world, the one who's already come and will come again. He's our hope, and He's the reason we can endure whatever we're facing. The truth is, life's tough. We face storms, challenges, disappointments. But in the middle of all of that, our hope isn't in ourselves. Our hope isn't in our ability to fix things. Our hope is in Jesus. Jesus who came to save us. Jesus who's going to come again and make all things new. That's what this season is about, looking to Jesus, the one who gives us hope that won't fail no matter how hard life gets. So now as we light the hope candle, I want it to be a reminder that Jesus is our hope, not just at Christmas, but every day. He came once and he's coming again. Let this candle remind you that Jesus is the hope we've been waiting for and the hope that we still wait for. So before we pray and before the worship team closes this service out, I wanna give you a simple challenge. This Advent season, where are you fixing your eyes? Are you focused on the storm? Are you focused on the struggles or the distractions in your life? Or are you fixing your eyes on Jesus, the source of our hope? I want to challenge you to take a few moments this week, today and this week, to focus on Jesus in a new way. Whether it's through prayer, through Bible, or simply sitting in silence. I know Pentecostals don't like that. It's good though. It's good to sit in silence and wait upon the Lord. Fix your eyes on him. Remember, hope's not just something we wish for. It's something we can live in because of Jesus. And if you're struggling today to find that hope, if you're facing a storm that feels overwhelming, I want to encourage you to come for prayer after I close in prayer. In fact, we're going to have a prayer team that's ready and waiting to pray with you, to stand with you, and to help you place your hope in Jesus. And this is the first, this is what would be called a step of faith. Because again, we operate by faith, not by feelings. There could be some of you today going through a very difficult circumstance and you just don't feel like getting up and walking forward for prayer. And you're probably thinking, Pastor Justin, I can pray in my seat and God can hear me right there. It's true, he can. But Jesus often challenged all throughout the New Testament. He would give these challenges to somebody, do this or do that, symbolizing their faith. So today I'm telling you, if you are going through something difficult, take a step of faith, walk down to the altar, and let us pray with you. Let us pray with you. If you don't feel like you have hope, let us pray with you. Again, we're not gonna pray that your situation or your circumstance changes today. That's not what this call is. This call is a call for God to help you remember that the power is God living in you and not in a different set of circumstances. So whatever you're facing today, I want to challenge you, come up, receive prayer from our prayer team, and ask for that hope that changes everything. Amen. Father, we thank you so much for sending Jesus to be our hope. God, as we lit this hope candle today, we remember that our hope is in Jesus and Jesus alone. So help us, God, today to keep our eyes on Jesus this Advent season, knowing he's with us and remembering that he will come again. And we ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.